Today's question, apprentice here. I was wondering if you could make a video about how to look through and label your codebook to find things more easily. I saw how neatly labeled your codebook is and wanted to do something similar. Patrick Vink from YouTube. All right, so my codebooks had a couple of different options here that I've done. Even today, every codebook I get, I tab all of it. There's some tabs I don't use. Like you'll notice this one's got every tab on all sides. I like to kind of go through the top and the sides. And then in the back things, I kind of keep those a little bit separately. Nowadays, I just go through on the front and then the back tables that I need at the very end of the book, I keep tabs up here. But notice that there are different tabs. So this set of tabs is color coordinated. So we've got all these different colors. They kind of keep each color separate, you know, so like all of chapter 3 is gonna be one thing. It's gonna be like one color, like yellow, and all of chapter 4 is gonna be orange. But there are tabs out there that are cheaper, and they still work just fine, but they're all yellow. So it makes looking through things when you don't really know code very well and you don't know where things are, it can make it a little bit more arduous to sit and look through. I like the color coding just because it's like, I know through flipping through this book so many times that everything in chapter 3 is gonna be yellow. So I already know, I'm like, if I'm looking for conductors, like 310, I'm looking yellow. I'm looking chapter 3, that's all I care about. So like none of this stuff, I know if I'm behind it, I know if I'm in front of it, it just makes it a lot easier when you do the colors. But it's okay to get these tabs too. It's just a little bit more difficult to see. And then these are pretty much the same thing as these. This is just a lot older. This is a 2014 book. But I do find that putting the tabs up here and down here actually makes it harder for you to find things because there's some things that are like really close to other things, but then you've run out of space down here and you had to go all the way up over here. So I find that you're like looking and then you have to look up again and it's like, oh shit, I missed it. And you got to look back down here. So I don't recommend doing it. I've actually got codebooks where I've gone on the bottom too, where I've just gone like one row all the way around the bottom and like another row all the way around. I don't recommend doing that at all. So my more recent codebook, this is how I do it. So I try to go pretty close, like I leave maybe an eighth of an inch in between each tab. And as I'm going, I just lay one an eighth of an inch away from the other ones. And I make sure that I don't grab the tab and flip the tab open to find the page. I like to put my finger on the tab and flip open all the pages before it so that when I open it, the tab is still like right here on this page. And if I'm looking for another thing, I'm going to like 215 on feeders, I just flip all the pages and boom, it's right there on that page. So that's just my personal preference. Now, the next thing I do once I've tabbed my entire book is I like to go highlight certain things just so it's easier for me to find those things. So the first thing I usually do is go to all of my relevant tables. So I like to go to grounding and bonding. So we've got 250 grounding and bonding. We've got figure 250.1, there's grounding and bonding, there's a table. I like to just like highlight the part 5 for bonding, the part 3 for grounding electrode conductor, the part 6 for equipment grounding and equipment grounding conductors. That just lets me know that's where those things are if I'm ever in 250 and I'm trying to figure that out. Then I go into 250.66, there's a table, table 250.66, I highlight that table. I used to highlight the entire column for copper on both sides just to let me know like that was where I was looking for information, but I've been doing this long enough that I know what this table's got in it, so I don't really worry about that anymore. Next one, I go to table 250.122 and I highlight the name of that table. Again, you could highlight the entire left-hand column and the entire middle column for all of your copper. Just lets you know what breaker sizes go with what conductor if you're doing an equipment grounding conductor. Table 310.16, again, I'm in the 2020 code, so if you're in the 2017, it's probably 310.15b16. If you're 2014 code, it's probably still 310.16. But I like to highlight that entire table. I like to highlight right in the middle between all of the copper conductors and all of the aluminum conductors. So the first four columns are one thing. It's all talking about copper conductors. The next four columns are all talking about aluminum conductors. So I usually highlight right down the middle of that. Then I flip back one page right before that. We've got table 310.15C1 adjustment factors for more than three current carrying conductors. I like to highlight that one because you're using that a lot to figure out however many current carrying conductors you've got in a conduit. You might have to derate the ampacity of those conductors. So I like to, I even write in there, does not apply to nipples. And then I put in parentheses 24 inches, just so that reminds me that this is not for nipples specifically. Then I go back one more page and we've got table 310.15B2 and B1. I usually highlight the title for both of these just so I know that these are my ambient correction factor tables. And that lets me know very quickly when I'm flipping through here, when I'm highlighting this stuff, and I go to the same places a lot, the highlighting just draws me right to it, so I don't have to waste time flipping in pages. So even if I'm like flipping through the general area, any highlighting I see is probably something important that I use all of the time. So that's what I would do. Now, I'm not gonna go through every single one of these, but there are some relevant tables. If you go into the 430s, into motors, 430.247, 248, 249, and 250, I would highlight those, at least the three-phase alternating current and the single-phase alternating current. Because you're gonna use those quite a bit. The other thing is I'll take a different highlighter and I will highlight all of the parts in all of the articles. That seems like a really arduous, crazy thing to do, but when you first start learning about code, knowing that you're in the right part is crucial. The amount of time that you're gonna spend looking at something and reading it and be like, nope, it says right there. And then somebody's gonna be like, no, you're completely wrong. That's not right. And you're like, no, I'm telling you. And they're like, yeah, flip back and look at what part you're in. You're in part four. That's like over 1,000 volt systems. It's not, it doesn't have anything to do with what we're talking about. So highlighting the parts in every single article, right? We've got chapters. Codebook has chapters, chapters 1 through 9. Within a chapter, you have tons of articles. So in chapter three, we have article 300 wiring methods. We have article 310 conductors. We have article 314. So 314.16 specifically is box fill. But if you go into a article specifically, like 250, article 250 is long. There's so much information in 250 that in 430 is the same way. So they've put multiple parts to kind of separate all of the information so that you know, like all of this code applies to one kind of thing. And then the next part is another kind of thing. So I like to highlight all of the parts throughout the entire book, just so I know, flipping through it, like, oh, I've just entered into a new part. So if I haven't found the code by now, I can read that that part has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. So I need to go back. But that's pretty much everything I would highlight. I like to keep the tabs up here, the white, you know, last few. That's my index, my annex D tables, which is all of your examples. Annex D is full of examples that you can practice doing dwelling calculations and sizing neutrals and all kinds of stuff like that. Annex C is your conduit and tubing tables. So anytime that you're trying to figure out how many conductors you can put in a piece of conduit, that's something we use all the time. And then chapter 9, tables 1 through 12. So again, you might be sizing conductors, trying to figure out how many differently sized conductors you can put in a certain conduit or something like that, but it gives the dimensions. So all four of those you're gonna use the crap out of. So I like to just separate them and put them up here at the top. And that's pretty much it. There's certain things that I'll write in here and write in little notes, or I'll highlight, you know, as I come across information. If I come across something all the time, especially now that I'm teaching code and I'm talking to people in the community about code, there's certain stuff that I come across and I'm like, oh yeah, that's right, I've heard that before. And I can never find it. I'm always digging around trying to figure out where it is. So I like to highlight stuff like that just so it's like it obvious and it sticks out to me when I'm flipping through all of this stuff. So hope that answers your question, my dude. Really appreciate the questions. So this year, I'm gonna be spending the entire year pretty much just answering your guys' questions, because I haven't done that in the past. I've always just kind of figured out like, these are the videos I think you'll like, but meanwhile, I've built up this catalog of like 5,000 questions. So let me know in the comments below if there's any kind of questions of other content you think that I should do. Be realistic with it. I mean, think about what I do for a living and still work out in the field and make videos. like realistic videos that I can make, not like, you should go to space and see what these electrical systems of NASA are. So anyways, go check out the merch, electricianu.com. And while you're there, sign up for some continuing education or some live classes. We have instructors standing by, literally doing nothing with their life other than just standing there. Like right there, standing, just standing there waiting for you to sign up for a class. So give them purpose. Let them have something to do. Come and take some classes from Electrician U. All right, guys and girls. Love you, crazies. See you in the next one. Discount music and video.